My dear students of medicine, good day and best of luck. The lectures presented here are on neuroanatomy of the module CNS 3011. The diagrams used for illustration are obtained from the Atlas of Neuroanatomy, which is prepared by Professor Fauzi Gaballa. Let us move now to the first slide. Let us begin these lectures by the study of the anatomy of the spinal cord. Spinal cord is a lower part of the central nervous system that lies within the vertebral canal of the vertebral column, and it is continuous above with the brain stem at the level of the foramen magnum. The spinal cord, as well as the brain, develop during intrauterine life from a single tube called the neural tube. And this neural tube becomes differentiated in its cranial part to become the brain by forming three vesicles, three neural vesicles, from before backward or from cranial to caudal. They are the forebrain vesicle, then caudal to it is a midbrain vesicle, and the caudal vesicle is a hindbrain vesicle. Three vesicles that will form the brain itself, while the caudal part of the tube remains narrower and will form the spinal cord. As regards the anatomy of the spinal cord in the adult, the spinal cord begins above at the level of the foramen magnum as the continuation of the brain stem, and the lower part of the brain stem is called medulla oblongata. Here in the diagram, number 5 is the foramen magnum, and here is the origin or the beginning of the upper part of the spinal cord, where it is continuous with the brain stem. The brain stem in the diagram is marked by number 4, and the spinal cord descends or lies in the vertebral canal, where it ends below at the level opposite the disc between the first and second lumbar vertebrae. And this level is very important in what is called the lumbar puncture, the procedure of introducing a needle in the subarachnoid space to get a sample of cerebrospinal fluid, or to inject the anesthetic drug in cases of what is called the spinal anesthesia. So this level in the adult, which is the lower end of the spinal cord at the level between the first and the second lumbar vertebrae, is very important. But below this level, the spinal cord ends in a fibrous cord called the phylum terminal. Phylum terminal, which is marked in the diagram by number 8, the lowermost part. And this phylum terminal, which is a fibrous cord, contains no nerve tissue. It continues through the sacral canal, the canal within the sacrum, to end below in the back, or attached in the back, on the back of the first coccygeal segment. Back of the coccyx, the first coccygeal segment, the first segment of the coccyx. This spinal cord, as regards its shape or morphology, it shows two enlargements, two bulges, one in the cervical region, marked by number 6, and is called the cervical enlargement, and it extends along the lower part of the cervical region of the vertebral column, extending opposite the lower 6 cervical vertebrae. And the spinal cord also shows another enlargement below, marked by number 7. It's called the lumbar enlargement. It is larger than the cervical enlargement and lies opposite the lower 3 lumbar vertebrae, the lower thoracic lumbar vertebrae, the lower thoracic lumbar vertebrae, 3 or 4, from the 9th to the 12th, from the 9th thoracic to the 12th thoracic. So number 7 is a lumbar enlargement of the spinal cord, and this lumbar enlargement ends below in a conical structure called the conus medullaris, cone-like structure, and from this cone the phylum terminal number 8 is attached. So the spinal cord lies within the upper two-thirds of the vertebral canal, and its lower limit lies opposite the disc between the first and the second lumbar vertebrae, and here the spinal cord ends in a conical enlargement called the conus medullaris, and from the tip of this conus medullaris the fibrous cord called the phylum terminal is attached. Phylum terminal is marked by number 8. Number 7 is a lumbar enlargement. It is a swelling in the spinal cord that lies opposite the 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th thoracic vertebrae, or simply the lower 3 thoracic vertebrae, the bodies of these vertebrae. Number 6 is a cervical enlargement. Cervical enlargement, and it lies in the region of the cervical vertebrae opposite the lower 6 cervical vertebrae, most of the cervical vertebrae, of course, except the first, and at the level of the foramen magnum number 5, the spinal cord is continuous with the brain stem, and the lower part of the brain stem is called the medulla oblongata. The brain stem in the figure is marked by number 4. In the figure we see structure number 3. This is the thalamus. It is a large mass of gray matter that lies above the level of the brain stem. It is a part of the brain. And number 1 is a cerebrum, cerebral hemisphere. Cerebral hemisphere. And number 2 is the cerebellum. And these structures form the parts of the brain. The brain is formed of the cerebrum, and the cerebrum consists of two cerebral hemispheres, and consists of the cerebellum, cerebellum number 2, and also it consists of two cerebellar hemispheres, and consists also of the brain stem. And the brain stem consists of the midbrain above, then the pons in the middle, then the medulla oblongata in the lower part, where it is continuous with the spinal cord. This picture shows the lower end of the spinal cord, where the lumbar enlargement lies. The lumbar enlargement here in the diagram is marked by number 1, and it is covered by sheaths of the meninges of the spinal cord called the pia mater. The spinal cord, as well as the brain, are surrounded by three meninges. Meninges are the sheaths of fibrous tissue that surround the brain and the spinal cord. These meninges that surround the brain are called cranial meninges, while the meninges that surround the spinal cord are the spinal meninges, the meninges around the spinal cord. And these meninges are three. The outer layer is strong and fibrous and is called the dura mater. Dura means strong. Then deeper to the dura mater, there is the arachnoid mater. And the deeper to the arachnoid mater is the pia mater. Three layers from outside to inside, from external to internal. The dura mater here of the spinal meninges is adherent to the vertebral bodies, the walls of the vertebral canal, to the bones of the vertebral canal, adherent to these canals, to these walls of the vertebral canal. The arachnoid mater lies deeper to the dura mater and has a space deeper to it called the subarachnoid space. Subarachnoid space, deeper to the arachnoid mater, and this space is characterized by being filled with cerebrospinal fluid in addition to the presence of the vessels of the spinal cord, arteries and veins, large arteries and veins of the spinal cord. So the subarachnoid space is a space deeper to the arachnoid mater, between it and the pia mater. The pia mater is the deepest and is adherent to the wall of the spinal cord, and therefore it is very soft and vascular. The space between the arachnoid mater and the pia mater is the subarachnoid space, which contains two main structures: the cerebrospinal fluid and the blood vessels that supply the spinal cord. Here in the diagram number 1 is the lumbar enlargement and is covered by the pia mater, the soft thin layer that is adherent to the outer surface of the spinal cord. And we can see here also the tip of the lumbar enlargement number 2, which forms a conical enlargement called conus medullaris. So number 2 marks the conus medullaris, the cone-like terminal part of the lumbar enlargement, cone-like. And at the tip of this cone, the pia mater extends alone in the form of the phylum terminale number 5. Because here the spinal cord ends and what remains is the pia mater. So the pia mater extends alone in the form of a fibrous tissue, forming a ligament or cord number 5 called phylum terminale. Phylum terminal means it's a terminal filament. Phylum means filament. Terminal because it's a terminal part of the spinal cord. Phylum terminal. Number 5, it is formed of pia mater, no nerve tissue. If it is cut, there will be no paralysis or no nervous manifestation. It is a fibrous tissue. And this phylum terminal descends in the subarachnoid space, as we see here. The subarachnoid space is a wide subarachnoid space here below the arachnoid mater, which is marked number 3, and is a pia mater. And in this wide lower part of the subarachnoid space, here lumbar puncture is carried out. lumbar puncture to insert a needle in this space to get a sample of the cerebrospinal fluid or to inject the anesthetic drug in a spinal anesthesia because it is wide. And also, it contains no spinal cord. No spinal cord. Spinal cord ends above as a disc between the first lumbar and the second lumbar. Here is the phylum terminal, and only the roots of the lower lumbar and the sacral nerves that pass downwards to reach their destination in the intervertebral foramina. In the formation of coda equina, which we shall see later. But there is no spinal cord. Spinal cord itself, no. Spinal cord ends above, at the disc between the first lumbar and second lumbar. So below the lumbar enlargement and the conus medullaris, there is a wide subarachnoid space filled with cerebrospinal fluid. It is the space which lies between the arachnoid matter externally and the biomatter internally. And you can see at number 6 is the lower end of this space. This is the bottom of the space. It ends here. And what is the level of this bottom? Opposite the second sacral segment. The second segment of the sacrum. Second sacral segment. Number 6 is the lower end of the pia mater, of the arachnoid mater, the lower end of the arachnoid mater, number 6. And here the phylum terminal number 5 pierces it and comes out. And outside this arachnoid, the phylum terminal becomes surrounded by a sheath of dura only, number 7, in the sacral canal. So number 7 is the phylum terminal in the sacral canal. It is surrounded by dura mater only and remains like this until it is attached to the back of the first coccygeal segment below number 8. Number 8 is the first coccygeal segment, the first segment of the coccyx. Here the phylum terminal is surrounded by dura mater. So the phylum terminal has two segments. An upper segment, number 5, lies in the subarachnoid space, and the lower segment lies in the sacral canal. It is only covered by the dura mater. This is the features of the lower part of the spinal cord. Number 4 in the diagram is the dura mater. Number 4 is the dura mater. Number 3 is the arachnoid mater. And number 2 is the pia mater covering the conus medullaris. And number 1 is the lumbar enlargement covered by the pia mater. Mater differs from mater. Mater in Germany means mother because it surrounds the spinal cord like a mother. Mater, one T. One T, mater. And pronounced matter, but the matter is a substance, double T. So there is a difference between matter, which is a layer of the meninges, and the matter. Matter is a substance, material, and the meninges is plural. The singular is meninx, meninx. This picture shows the position of the central canal of the spinal cord, which lies in the center of the gray matter of the cord. It is marked here in the diagram by number 1. Its lower part in the lumbar enlargement and in the conus medullaris, it is dilated here in its lower part to form what is called the terminal ventricle. Ventricle means dilated part, wide part. And the terminal because it is in its terminal part, the terminal part of the central canal. And this central canal of the spinal cord contains cerebrospinal fluid. Number three is the wide lower part of the subarachnoid space that surrounds the phylum terminale, which is marked by number four. Phylum terminale is the continuation of the pia mater at the apex of the conus medullaris. So this is the position of the terminal ventricle of the central canal of the spinal cord. This picture shows a transverse section in the spinal cord. It shows a central H-shaped gray matter, gray in color. And this H-shaped gray matter is surrounded by tracts of nerve fibers called white matter. White matter. The gray matter consists of posterior horns and anterior horns, or dorsal horns and ventral horns on each side. And these horns are connected, of both sides, are connected together in the middle through a commissure called the gray commissure. Commissure means a connecting segment between corresponding parts of two sides. And here, this gray commissure is traversed by the central canal of the spinal cord, marked by number three. In the diagram, number three is the central canal of the spinal cord in section. It passes through the center of the spinal cord in the center of the gray commissure. The gray commissure is in the midline of the cord. The gray commissure that connects the gray matter of the right side with the gray matter of the left side. Gray matter, called gray because most of its content are nerve cells, and this content of nerve cells gives it this color, gray color, and therefore it's called gray matter. While the white matter surrounding this gray matter is called white because it is mainly formed of fibers, nerve fibers, and the nerve fibers are white in color, and therefore the structure around the gray matter is called white matter. Number seven here in the figure is the anterior or ventral horn, because it looks like a horn, ventral or anterior horn of the gray matter, and its cells are motor in function and are called anterior horn cells, are motor in function and are called anterior horn cells. Motor because they supply the skeletal muscles, the skeletal muscles. For example, the skeletal muscles in the limbs and in the trunk. And if these cells, anterior horn cells, are destroyed or damaged, there will be paralysis. Paralysis of the supplied muscles. Number eight is the dorsal horn or posterior horn. It's narrower. as compared with the ventral horn. And its cells are sensory cells. It's a content of nerve cells. These cells are sensory. In some sections, as in, for example, the thoracic region, there is an extra horn between the ventral and the dorsal horns, in between them, in the depression or the concavity between the dorsal horn number 8 and the ventral horn number 7, in the concavity opposite the gray commissure and the central canal number 3, here in the thoracic region mainly, there is an additional small horn called lateral horn on each side. Lateral horn. And this lateral horn contains autonomic nerve cells. Autonomic nerve cells. These autonomic nerve cells may be sympathetic or parasympathetic. They are sympathetic in the regions of the thoracic segments, all the thoracic segments and the upper two lumbar. Only the cells here in the lateral horn are sympathetic. While the lateral horn, the lateral horns in the sacral region, in the sacral region, the sacral segment number 2, 3, and 4, only the lateral horns contain parasympathetic nerve cells. So, in general, the ventral horns of the gray matter, number 7 in the diagram, contains motor cells to skeletal muscles, anterior horn cells. Number 8 is the dorsal or posterior horn of gray matter. Contains sensory cells that receive common sensation. That receives common sensation. Common sensation like touch, like pain, like pressure, like sensation of temperature, like proprioception. These are common sensations, or general sensations, because they are present in the whole body. This is the dorsal horn or posterior horn of the gray matter. Sensory cells, marked by number 8. But as I mentioned, there are an extra smaller horn called the lateral horn. Lies between the dorsal horn and the ventral horn, and is present in certain sites. For example, in the cervical region, there are no lateral horns. There are no lateral horns. In the region between the second lumbar and the second sacral segments of the spinal cord, also there are no lateral horns. These lateral horns lie only at the thoracic region from thoracic 1 to thoracic 12 and upper two lumbar segments. In addition, in the sacral region, the lateral horns are present at the second, third, and fourth sacral segments. They contain autonomic nerve cells. Autonomic nerve cells. Sympathetic in the whole thoracic and upper two lumbar, and the parasympathetic in the sacral segments only. Sacral 2, 3, and 4. These are the horns of the gray matter, which takes the shape of an H shape. In section, but I wanted to say that along the whole column along the whole column. These horns are called columns of gray matter, columns, longitudinal columns. But when we take a section, it appears as a horn. But if we look at the spinal cord as a whole, from the sides, for example, we see these horns in the form of longitudinal columns, called the gray column, ventral gray column, and the posterior gray column. But in section, it appears like here in the diagram, like a horn. In addition to this gray matter, and I said that number three is the central canal of the spinal cord lying in the center of the gray commissure. In front of this gray commissure, there is an area white, number six, is called the white commissure, because it contains nerve fibers. And here, the nerve fibers in this white commissure connects corresponding parts of both sides of the spinal cord. But it is not gray, but white, formed of nerve fibers. And therefore, number six is called white commissure. And thus, we have two commissures. A gray commissure, number three, traversed by the central canal, and in front of it, the white commissure, number six. And in front of this white commissure, there is a deep fissure, number five, median fissure. Number five is a deep fissure in the midline anteriorly, and therefore it's called anterior median fissure. And in the living, it lodges the anterior spinal artery that supplies the anterior part of the spinal cord. It lodges mainly the anterior spinal artery. It is a deep fissure. The difference between a fissure and a sulcus is the fissure is deeper, while the sulcus is shallower. And here in the spinal cord, we have number two is a posterolateral sulcus, one on each side. And you have number one, a posterior median sulcus, shallow groove, shallow groove. The posterolateral, because it is posterior and lateral. Because the anterior aspect of the section is marked by the anterior horns, the large anterior horns, and the anterior median fissure, number five. This differentiates the anterior aspect from the posterior aspect of the section. So number two is the postero, because it lies on the posterior aspect and the lateral at the same time. So it is called the posterolateral, at the angle between posterior and the lateral, one on each side. And this posterolateral sulcus, a shallow groove, number two, is the site where the dorsal roots of spinal nerves are attached. The dorsal roots along the whole column, dorsal roots of spinal nerves, dorsal roots which are sensory, the dorsal roots are sensory, are attached here at the posterolateral sulcus number two, while the ventral roots of the spinal nerves are attached at the point marked by number four, a very, very shallow, very faint sulcus. For the ventral roots of the spinal nerves, and the ventral roots of the spinal nerves contain mainly motor fibers, in addition to autonomic fibers, at certain sites. This is number four. Number nine, in the section is a septum of fibers called neuroglia. Neuroglia means connective tissue element of the central nervous system. They are not responsible for transmission of nerve impulses, but they are like connective tissue elsewhere in the body. But in the nervous system, the connective tissue is called neuroglia. They are not transmitting nerve impulses. If they are cut, they will not produce paralysis. Connective tissue in the central nervous system, brain or spinal cord, called the neuroglia. The septum here, number 9, is a septum of this neuroglia, fibrous tissue of or connective tissue of the central nervous system, forming a septum to divide the right side from the left side of the posterior part of the spinal cord. It is not present anteriorly, because what separates the right side from the left side anteriorly is the anterior median fissure, number 5. There is no septum here. Anteriorly, there is no septum here. There is only the anterior median fissure, number 5, and the anterior white commissure, the white commissure, number 6, the white commissure. But posteriorly, the right and left sides are separated by this septum. Posterior median septum of neuroglia. These are the features of this section, transverse section of the spinal cord. This picture shows the spinal segment. The spinal segment is defined as the part of the spinal cord that is connected by the roots of a single spinal nerve on each side. The two roots of a single spinal nerve on each side. The segment that receives these roots of a single spinal nerve is called a spinal segment. The spinal cord receives the roots of 31 spinal nerves, and therefore it consists of 31 spinal segments. Each segment is connected to a spinal nerve, one on each side. Here in the diagram is a spinal segment. One segment is marked by number 1. Number 1 is a spinal segment. Number 2 is the dorsal root of the spinal nerve. And this dorsal root carries sensory fibers only. And carries also a ganglion, sensory ganglion, also called the spinal ganglion, marked by number 2, contains cells. A ganglion is a collection of nerve cells outside the spinal cord. If these cells are present inside the spinal cord, it's called the nucleus. Nucleus, a group of cells inside the spinal cord or inside the brain. It's called the nerve nucleus. But collection of cells outside the spinal cord or outside the brain is called the ganglion. And these ganglia may be somatic, sensory, or may be autonomic according to their function. Here in the spinal nerve, number 3, is a sensory ganglion. And because it lies on the dorsal root, it's called the dorsal root ganglion. And related to the spinal nerve, also called the spinal ganglion. Note that it is very close to the trunk of the nerve. The trunk of the nerve is number 4, and the trunk of the nerve is formed by the union of the dorsal root number 2 and the ventral root number 5. The ventral root number 5 of the spinal nerve contains motor fibers. The dorsal root number 2 contains sensory fibers. As they join each other, they form the trunk. The trunk is number 4, mixed nerve. Contains mixed fibers. Mixed means sensory and motor. Sensory and motor. and it is a short segment, this trunk, a short segment, and lies in the intervertebral forum. Only in the intervertebral forum, because as it comes out from the intervertebral foramen, it divides immediately into an anterior primary ramus and a posterior primary ramus. So the trunk of any spinal nerve lies only in the intervertebral foramen, and it is a mixed nerve containing the motor fibers and sensory fibers. And if it is damaged, there would be motor manifestations, paralysis in the muscles, and the sensory manifestations, loss of sensation. But if the dorsal root is cut or paralyzed or destroyed, for example, number two is cut, dorsal root, there will be sensory loss only. And if the motor root, number five, is cut or destroyed, there will be motor paralysis only. But the trunk, because it is mixed, if it is damaged or destroyed, there will be both motor loss of function and the sensory loss of function. This is a spinal segment attached to one spinal nerve, one on each side, of course. This picture shows types of fibers in the roots of a spinal nerve, the dorsal root and the ventral root. We know that the dorsal root contains only sensory fibers. These sensory fibers have their cells of origin in the dorsal root ganglia. Here in the diagram, there is a nerve cell body in the ganglion, in the dorsal root ganglion, and this nerve cell, which is a sensory nerve cell, gives two processes. A peripheral process number two and a central process number one. The peripheral process number two passes peripherally towards the periphery to reach the skin, to reach the bones, to reach the joints, to get or collect sensory stimuli from these areas and bring these sensory stimuli to the cell body in the ganglion, and from the ganglion the sensory stimuli pass through the central root, the central process number one. The central process number one carries the sensory stimuli to the spinal cord. So the central process number one enters the spinal cord to relay on a sensory nucleus there. And it is called central because it enters the central nervous system. So the body of the sensory nerve cell in the dorsal root ganglion with its two processes form a sensory neuron. A neuron is defined as a nerve cell body with its dendrites and its axon. So this is a sensory neuron, and it is the first sensory neuron on the sensory pathway. Then, what about the ventral root? In the ventral root, there are two types of fibers. Number four is a motor fiber arising from the anterior horn cell that lies in the anterior horn of the spinal cord, and it will pass into the ventral root, then through the trunk of the nerve, then it enters finally into the muscles to supply it. But in addition to this motor fiber number four, there is a sympathetic fiber number five, because this figure is in the sympathetic area in the thoracic region. So number five is a sympathetic fiber that arises from a sympathetic cell that lies in the lateral horn of the gray matter. The lateral horn of the gray matter is a small horn that lies in the side of the gray matter between the dorsal or posterior horn posteriorly and the ventral horn anteriorly. And this small lateral horn lodges the sympathetic nerve cells. From the sympathetic nerve cells arise the preganglionic fibers, number five, that passes through the ventral root of the spinal nerve. Then these fibers leave the spinal nerve to relay in a sympathetic ganglion, because it is a sympathetic fiber. And relay means a synapse. This relay means that this fiber ends here and a new neuron arises. So in this number three ganglion, which is a sympathetic ganglion, a new neuron arises with a cell body and axon. And the fiber arising here from the ganglion is called postganglionic fiber. And in between this postganglionic fiber and the preganglionic fiber that arises from the lateral horn of the spinal cord, there is a synapse, there is a gap in between where a neurotransmitter is secreted. A neurotransmitter is secreted. So there is a relay in the sympathetic ganglion and in any autonomic ganglion in general, sympathetic or parasympathetic. But as regards the dorsal root ganglia, there is no relay. This is the difference between a dorsal root ganglion and an autonomic ganglion. So this picture shows the types of fibers in the dorsal root and ventral root of a spinal nerve. This picture shows the direction and the length of the roots of the spinal nerves along the whole extent of the spinal cord as it lies within the vertebral canal of the vertebral column. And we know that the spinal cord occupies only the upper two-thirds of the vertebral canal, because it ends below at the level of the disc between lumbar one and lumbar two. And therefore the origin of the roots are not always opposite the intervertebral foramen, because the lower intervertebral foramen in the lumbar region and sacral region are far apart, lower than the origin of the nerves from the spinal cord. And this is the explanation why the roots of the spinal nerves are oblique and even vertical in the lower part. We have to know that the roots of the spinal nerves, the roots means dorsal roots and ventral roots, lie within the vertebral canal. But the trunks of the spinal nerves lie in the intervertebral foramen only. So here in the figure we see the first and the second cervical nerves are horizontal, directly horizontal from the spinal cord to the intervertebral foramen, because they lie opposite to each other. But as we go downward in the cervical region, the roots become slightly oblique, as marked by the letter C. In the thoracic region, marked by letter T, the roots become more oblique. And in the region of the lumbar and sacral, marked by letter L and S, the roots become more and more oblique. And in the lower lumbar and the whole sacral and coccygeal roots, they become vertical, in direction. And this vertical roots because as I said, the intervertebral foramina are far lower away from the lower end of the spinal cord, and these vertical fibers of the lower lumbar and all sacral and the coccygeal nerves form what is called the coda equina. Coda equina around, surrounding the phylum terminal. The phylum terminal, which is a prolongation downward of the pia mater, it is a fibrous cord. So these roots of the lower lumbar and all sacral and coccygeal nerves surround the phylum terminal in the lower third of the vertebral canal, where the subarachnoid space is very wide, and this arrangement is called coda equina. Coda equina, coda من coda من the lower part towards the tail, and equina from horse, from the tail of the horse. The name comes from the tail of the horse. As regards the length of the roots, the cervical roots are the shortest, while the lower lumbar and the sacral are the largest, are the longest, because of the wide distance between their origin from the spinal cord and their exit from the intervertebral foramina. This diagram shows the coda equina, which is formed of the lower lumbar and all sacral and the first coccygeal nerves that lie in the lower part of the vertebral canal, as well as in the sacral canal. And these roots, dorsal and ventral roots of these spinal nerves, surround the phylum terminal, which is a prolongation of pia mater from the conus medullaris of the spinal cord. So here in the figure number one is the conus medullaris, the cone-like lower end of the spinal cord. And from here, the lower lumbar and all sacral and the first coccygeal nerves arise. And these nerves are surrounding the phylum terminal, which here is marked by number two. Number two marks the phylum terminal, which is a filament, fibrous filament, that descends from the apex of the conus medullaris, the conus medullaris number one, downward, extending downward to end below, to get attached to the first coccygeal segment. The first coccygeal segment, marked by number five. So it comes out from the sacral canal, from the lower part of the sacral canal. This is the phylum terminal. Around it, the lower lumbar roots and all sacral roots and the first coccygeal root surround this phylum terminal, and they are marked in the figure by number three. Number three are the roots of the nerves that form the coda equina. Number four marks the sacral canal, the canal within the sacrum bone, the sacrum, which is a single bone, as you know. But above this sacral canal is the lower part of the vertebral canal. Note the direction of exit of the roots, how they exit obliquely above, then become vertical below, and pass out through the intervertebral foramina. The coda equina lies in the lower part of the subarachnoid space of the spinal cord, which is filled with cerebrospinal fluid. And from this space, cerebrospinal fluid sample can be withdrawn, can be taken by lumbar puncture, which is called a process called procedure called lumbar puncture. And here there is no possibility of injury to the spinal cord, because the spinal cord ends above higher at the disc between lumbar 1 and lumbar 2, and this coda equina is lower. And usually the lumbar puncture is carried out at the disc between lumbar 3 and lumbar 4, lower than the lower end of the spinal cord. There is only the possibility of hitting one of the roots, but this will not be injured because the roots of the spinal nerves are movable. So the needle may not enter one of them, may just gets in contact with it. But higher up, where the spinal cord is present, and if the needle is inserted higher up, it will pass through the tissue of the spinal cord. The spinal cord is fixed in position. But here, in the coda equina, the roots are long and movable. So there is no fear, to injure any one of them. This picture shows the structure of the coda equina and its position in the subarachnoid space, which is filled with cerebrospinal fluid. This picture shows the trunk of a spinal nerve, as it lies in the intervertebral foramen. We know that the trunk of a spinal nerve is the union between the dorsal root, which is sensory, and the ventral root, which is motor. And we know that the dorsal root carries the dorsal root ganglion that lies close to the intervertebral foramen. And also we know that the dorsal root and the ventral root of a spinal nerve lie within the vertebral canal, where they are attached to the side of the spinal cord. So here in the figure, number 4 is one of the roots of the spinal nerve. And because it is directed towards the anterior aspect of the spinal cord, so this is a ventral root. The ventral root, as well as the dorsal root, lie within the vertebral canal. But the trunk is marked by number 2. This trunk lies in the intervertebral foramen, and the intervertebral foramen is a short foramen, very short foramen. And the trunk is also short. And once the trunk comes out from this intervertebral foramen, it will bifurcate into anterior primary ramus and the posterior primary ramus, two divisions, which will form the spinal nerves. But the trunk itself, I repeat, is in the intervertebral foramen. Here, we are demonstrating the structures in the intervertebral foramen. Number 2 is a trunk, is one of the contents of the intervertebral foramen. Number 1 is an artery, a spinal branch, arterial spinal branch to the spinal cord that passes through the intervertebral foramen to supply the spinal cord. Spinal branch, spinal arterial branch that comes from the arteries outside the vertebral canal, as for example from the posterior intercostal arteries, as for example from the lumbar arteries. So number 1 is a spinal arterial branch that passes through the intervertebral foramen to supply the spinal cord. Number 3 is a nerve, spinal nerve, a spinal sensory nerve arising from the trunk or from the spinal nerve itself after leaving the intervertebral foramen and pass through the intervertebral foramen, returning back, and therefore it's called recurrent because it returns back. Recurrent branch. And because it enters the vertebral canal to supply the meninges around the spinal cord, it is called recurrent meningeal branch. You can call it simply a sensory nerve to the dura mater, a sensory nerve to the meninges, or a meningeal branch from the spinal nerve. But it lies in the intervertebral foramen on its way to enter to supply the dura. And this is of importance in clinical application, because if the dura mater is inflamed in a disease called the meningitis, inflammation of the meninges, if the dura mater is inflamed, meningitis, this meningeal branch becomes irritated. And the irritation of this branch will produce spasm of the muscles of the back. The muscles of the back on each side of the vertebral column, on each side of the spines of the vertebral column, on the back, leading to their spasm and contraction, and leading to extension of the back, extension with pain due to irritation of these sensory branches. The irritation of these sensory branches will be referred to the muscular branches from the spinal nerves to, that supply the muscles of the back of the trunk and the back of the neck in cases of meningitis. This explains why there is arching of the back and arching of the neck in cases of meningitis of the spinal cord, because of this simple nerve. Each intervertebral foramen has this nerve, each one from each spinal nerve. So number two is the trunk of the spinal nerve in the intervertebral foramen. Number one is a spinal arterial branch that supplies the spinal cord with blood. Number three is this meningeal branch called the recurrent meningeal branch that passes through the intervertebral foramen to supply the meninges around the spinal cord. And number four shows the roots of the spinal nerve as they lie in the vertebral canal.